I am honored to be here with you, and it's always a pleasure when I come to Coimbra, so I don't deserve those wonderful presentation, but thank you. So, if you have, as we are few, if you have something to ask while I'm speaking, it's not a problem, say that, and we can allow it, so don't hesitate to ask even while I'm talking. Thank you. Well, why this apparently boring topic, prolongati literature in late Renaissance Italy? Among the topics that Italian Renaissance resumed from the ancients, senility was retrieved as well. And it seems to me quite interesting taking it into consideration today, in these days in which at least in Italy, but I think all over Europe and beyond, the everyday life of elderly people and the idea that we have of them has been, is being strongly questioned following the dramatic experience of the emergency. I think to their everyday life, the access to healthcare, their right to self-determination, so their freedom. So, as it happens in many regards concerning human individuality, I believe that Renaissance reprocessed even the idea of aging and its dissemination. And I believe that the rephrasing was crucial in the unfolding of modern sensibilities. I will focus on some meaningful literary works of Italian Renaissance, acting as focal points and ranging from the end of 15th to the end of 16th century. So to include the two most disruptive cultural events of the early modernity, the printing press and the counter-reformation, basically. And here we are. Renaissance literature dealt with the topic of senility with every kind of text, dialogue, poems, treatises, letters, and the topic was generally retrieved according to three main traditions. That's to say, the Bible with its characters and tales, the classic literature, but in particular Cicero's Cactomaior de Senectute, which was reprinted in Latin and Italian translation throughout the 16th century, and the Galenic medicine, the humoral theory in particular. The medical knowledge of Galen's humoral theory was rediscovered at the beginning of the 16th century, thanks to the diffusion of new Latin translation from the alleged Greek original versions. A moral perspective innervated the three frames, each one had its own morality. And we see that Italian literature of the Renaissance did not reject any of them, but rather blended ancient patterns, adding to those reading further reinterpretation. For the period we consider, this new frame started right from the medical text. And here, we have physician and astrologer and many other things, Marsilius Ficino. Preserving health as to foster a long life was a recurrent issue into Galenic works, as well as into handbooks of practical medicine written in the Middle Age, and then published in Latin and then later in vernacular languages. We shall soon return to them. In 1589, Marsilio Ficino published a book that is held for a milestone in Renaissance culture, far beyond its Neoplatonic framework. I refer to De Vita Triplici, or the Three Books of Life, in which Marsilio Ficino specifically dealt with the health of scholars and intellectuals, performing a great synthesis of ancient Eastern knowledge and humanistic sensibilities, myth and medicine, astrology and philosophy, magic and literature. The second book of the work, De Vita Longa, teaches precautions, behaviors, and remedies to prolong life in the learned man, exactly the kind of human being, the learned man, that deserves to be at the center of humanistic thought. I pinpoint here that every young Italian student still today learns by heart that humanism and Renaissance put the human being, I quote, at the center of the universe. They are usually not taught what kind of human being, and sometimes they obtain a degree believing that humanists were humanitarians and democratics, more or less. Well, to the purpose of a virtuous intellectual life, old age reveals to be, in Ficino, the ideal human state, mainly because of its experience and the capacity to tame passions. But those are values already inherent to the model of wise men existing in the Bible and in Latin rhetoric, both civil and literary and poetic. But Ficino goes further, and the old age becomes worth living only for those men who have qualities and goodwill to be somehow helpful for other human beings, whilst it seems rough people don't deserve even the possibility to pursue it. And there I quote from the first chapter, a sort of preface. But I have no wish to impart this instruction, the instruction to pursue a long life, to indolent and lazy people. For why should we wish those people to live longer who do not even live, as if we were nourishing drones and not bees? Nor do I wish them to be divulged to people who are dissolute through their corrupt passion for pleasures, fools who far prefer the brief pleasure that lasts only one day, nor disclosed to the wicked and unjust, whose life is the death of good men, but only to prudent and temperate people of sophisticated intelligence who will benefit mankind, whether in the private or in the public sphere. So only refined intellectual can live long, according to Marsilio Ficino. This idea of a useful Senex is neither the piety of Aeneas towards Anchise, nor the severe respect due to the biblical fathers and sages. It's not even remotely the atmosphere that we find in Cicero's Catomaior, where the praise of old age totally dealt with human virtues, wholly based in the awareness of one's past civil righteousness. And the peaceful enjoyment of agriculture and other pious entertainments is nothing but a just remuneration for that commendable past. Another implication of the statement is that even in the elderly, a healthy body is essential for a healthy mind. But the mind holds primacy, and the intellectual life along with it. In Ficino's depiction of old age, we find some more distinctive features that took roots and flourished into the Renaissance culture, and smoothly survive the Catholic Reformation, or Counter-Reformation. In fact, I believe that Counter-Reformation is the meaning that I prefer, and I hold for rights. But sometimes it's automatic, I recur in Catholic Reformation. So we said, Ficino's text survived even Catholic Reformation, and even in its more questionable esoteric content. Here an example. I show you a work that has no depth at all, as either for thought or for style. But it well represents the common reception and the awkward juxtaposition of the different traditions through years. Priest and writer Giovanni Poliziano from Genoa dedicated a dialogue on senility to the noble Antonio Doria, a member of the Doria family of Genoa. The 90% of the booklet is a rework of Cicero Catomaior in a breezier style, a bit lighter. But around the end, Poliziano attaches a single, almost entire chapter from Ficino's De Vita Longa, which is not exactly cohesive either to Cicero's morality or to new Catholic mood toward paganism, or only to syncretic humanism. It is drawn from the chapter 11 of Ficino De Vita Longa, whose title is On the Use of Human Milk and Blood for the Life of Old People, Something Magical. And they are immediately after the age of 70, I quote, choose a young girl who is healthy, beautiful, cheerful, temperate, and when you are hungry and the moon is waxing, suck her milk, immediately eat a little powder of sweet fennel properly mixed with sugar. Why shouldn't our old people, namely, who have no other recourse, likewise suck the blood of a youth? A youth, I say, who is willing, healthy, happy, and temperate. So the youth should agree that we suck blood from him. They will suck, therefore, like leeches, an ounce or two from a scarcely open vein of the left arm. So the priest, Giovanni Poliziano, writes this passage from Ficino with no credit to him. So he quotes Cicero, but he doesn't quote Ficino, and then adds, but those are witches' remedies, so it's not my fault. But meanwhile, he wrote it in the mid 1547. Yes, we were not in the full of the severe Counter-Reformation, but the Council of Trent had already begun. So situation for magicians was becoming trickier too. Just to say how the things went. And here, back to Regimina Sanitatis, toward the mid of 16th century, a Paduan businessman published a slim Regimen Sanitatis, a slim handbook of practical medicine, who became quickly a real bestseller and, by curious paths, became later famous in several European countries. The main point of the treatise on the sober life by Alvise Cornaro was that a sustainable senility directly depended on diet. That is pretty much what Ficino restated in his chapter 8 of the Vita Longa, whose title was, "The diet should be the elderly medicine." Alvise Cornaro stressed the responsibility of the single individual in understanding and deciding the diet that would better suit his needs, applying the human reason to his experience. As for the success of the book in Europe, the work's strong point was not the medical content, but rather the author's relation with the book's object. Cornaro wrote about aging using the first-person narrative, admitting he was an old man. Nevertheless, he was hale and hearty, and not only serene, but even happy. And this happiness comes only partially from the experience of a total lack of illness, from the experience of an healthy body. Rather, his physical wellness allows him to enjoy many more intellectual pleasures that delight him and become themselves medical remedies in turn. And there I quote from the English version. "I meet in there, in my friend's company, men distinguished for their intellect, architects, painters, sculptors, musicians, agriculturists. For our time, I've certainly produced a considerable number of these. I behold for the first time their more recent works and see again their former ones. And I always learn things which it is agreeable and pleasing to me to know." Within his possibilities in the real life, old Cornaro, who died at 84, more or less, old Cornaro was a patron of the arts, and in this Paduan villa in the city, he had a little theater built for his own musical representation and for the theater representation, for the piece of theater who wrote for him his friend Ruzzante, who was a famous Venetian screenplayer, quite famous in Italy. Ficino, who devoted many passages into his work to the power of music, recommended it in particular to old people to fight melancholic situation and train their confidence with harmony. And here a quotation, a brief quote from Ficino. "Those who have already completed their 49th year and are near in the 50th, they should take up music again, if perchance they have neglected it, which should never happen." Nor Cornaro forgets the importance of a wholesome dwelling, which he does not confine to the quality of the air intended as temperature, wetness, and salubrousness. In the Galenic medical theory, air was intended as the quality of the ambience. It was one of the six non-natural elements influencing the health of human being. That is to say, things extraneous to the natural elements composing the body, thus not air, water, or fire, or health. The other five non-natural elements were food and drink, move and rest, there went in couple, sleep and wakefulness, repletion and expression, and that there were the passions of mind. Above these elements, men could act without, with no remedies, with no, without recurring to extraneous things and without assume external things in his body, except for food and drink that had a completely different than development and was at the center of practical and preventive medicine in 16th century. So to come to our Cornaro, it was so important, air and ambience for Cornaro, that a wholesome dwelling had to be pursued through architecture, so one of the noblest mechanical arts of Renaissance. All these things I do, this, so the wholesome dwelling, all these things, all his pleasure, I do with the greatest ease at my leisure, at their proper season, in my own residence. It is so arranged that in one part of it, I am protected against the great heat of the summer, and in the other part against the extreme cold of the winter. For I build the house according to the principles of architecture, which teach us how that should be done. In addition to the mansion, I enjoy my various garden, beautified by running streams, retreats wherein I always find some pleasant occupation for my time. I especially delight in its extremely comfortable and fine dwelling. To the author, for a good quality of the old age, the functional sides of housing seem to be as essential as its aesthetic value. And he seems to have well internalized the early humanistic sociality between architecture and music in the name of harmony. Cornaro gets very close to the model of useful Senex drafted by Ficino. Intellectual, lively, useful to his community and family as well, at least he wrote to be useful to his family in his writing, so we must believe him. Even if he is not the kind of pure humanist, of refined intellectual, whom perhaps Ficino had in mind 50 years before. And a further characteristic of the good senility that we find in Ficino and onwards through 16th century and 17th also, is liberty. Elderly people must and can escape intellectual servitude and run their life free. Here, for an example of the many passages which Ficino devoted to the concept, the idea of freedom in old age, in intellectual man. And liber too, here liber is the Latin god that was equal to Dionysus, so fertility and wine together. And liber too, planter of the wine, propagator of life, will preserve it too in liberty. Liber himself always ate slaves, and that life which he promises by wine, he gives it for long only to free people. Cornaro's old man is not only free from the bondage of passions and vices, but also from the power of the stars that Ficino probably would ever never said. Our birth, he wrote, is subject to the revolution of the heavens, which have great power over it, especially with regard to the formation of good and bad constitution. This is a condition which nature cannot alter. She hopes, however, that man, being gifted with intellect and reason, will himself supply by art that which the heavens have denied him, and that by means of the temperate life, he may succeed in freeing himself of his bad constitution and be enabled to enjoy a long life. And there is no doubt that man can, by means of art, free himself partially from the control of the heavens, the common opinion being that, while they influence, they do not compel us. So with human action, with its reason, man can also can also win in part, partially, the stars and the power of the planets, which presided to its own constitution, its own temperament. Finally, considering his long experience and bright reason, old Cornaro is free to decide what kind of medical treatment to follow, despite even the physician's opinion. And then we come to a further step. And so the mid of the Counter-Reformation, the end of the 16th century. This book, The Good of Senility, in English more or less, written by Cardinal Gabriele Paleotti in 1595, but published 2 years later, takes us straight after the Council of Trent. Cardinal Paleotti had already written one of the most influential treatises on post-Tridentine visual art, the idea. He wrote the most famous handbook of interpretation of visual art in, according the ideal of Council of Trent. It was the Sacris et Profanis Imaginibus in 1582. These words well depict how the idea of a virtuous and yet satisfying senility evolved in the Italian religious context, a concept that was going to rule the general field of morality for a long, long, long time. Paleotti's human model is a champion, was a champion of the post-Tridentine spirituality, Holy Filippo Neri. Nonetheless, Paleotti's writing often reveals some lively prose pretty much close to the lay mannerist literature. I have inserted a couple of the first two examples when he writes, he lives in Rome, Filippo Neri lives in Rome, that is to say in the theater of the world. And then a bit further, among all things created by our supreme monarch and creator of the universe in this wonderful machine of the world, the making and manufacture of man was by far the most surprising. We find many places, many passages in Paleotti in which he used this typical, almost Baroque elements of the machine, the mechanism, theater, applied to the concept of human being, human mind, human spirit, even human spirit. It is quite interesting for the style. But Paleotti recognized that the liberty of senility belongs to Christian universe and lays in the free will, the characteristic that distinguished par excellence the Catholics from the Protestants, so free will against servo arbitrio. Therefore, I say that senescence will be more eligible to make a good use of the free will, which mostly consists in the matter, the species, and the order. And as such a thing requires extreme caution, attention, and maturity, all specific qualities of senilities. A further kind of liberty, according Paleotti, connected to the Christian spiritus as well, is the elderly's freedom of speech, in which the classic theory meets Aquinas and St. Paul. People are not completely free to talk as long as they are worried that somehow could jeopardize their own interest. But the wise and experienced old man who knows, wants, and can, is not afraid to compromise any interests of his. It happens that the old man, free from any quest for honors, any mundane concern, any appetite for worldly gods, talks freely about whatever he likes, to whomever he likes, and whenever he likes, since, as the apostle says, ubi spiritus ibi libertas. But most important, perhaps, Paleotti attempts to bend the metaphoric negative significance of oldness and old age. He devoted two important places of the work, thus the beginning, the preface, and the foreword, to demonstrate that the idea of oldness and old age, associated with detrimental meanings, comes from the Christian rhetoric of Paul. I quote, "Therefore we find that the whole human race has been called with two different names, the old man corrupt by the sin, and the new man delivered from that very sin. But the idea of oldness and the idea of old age, held for hateful and evil after the triumph of our Lord and Redeemer, does not include those bad metaphors anymore. And on the contrary, today that very old age comprehends many illustrious and virtuous examples, such as the fathers of the church and the saints." This could deserve a deeper investigation into Catholic texts of the time. For instance, the rhetoric of the old man against the new man as a typical Pauline topic is very frequent into the religious work of Italian heretics such as Bernardino Kino, Marcantonio Flaminio, and Benedetto Fontanini, and in Juan de Valdez, who was not Italian but wrote mostly his religious treatises and mystical treatises in Italy. And the other topic to inquire would be if there is some connection about this on the fact that the figure Christ is a religious hero who dies young. So Christ is a young hero against the oldness, the old age of the biblical hero of the ancient testament. So it would be quite long and specific quest into the text, but I think that it could bring something interesting. Just to say something more about the religious rework of the issue. In the end, there are at least two points in the idea of senility developed from Italian Renaissance that touch our contemporary reality. Firstly, the possibility that old people can be active and useful is perceived as somewhat imperative, compulsory. Useful and active, whatever it takes, I added. It has a good side, for example, a constant work to improve the quality of life in old age on behalf of society, of public welfare, and most of all of scientific research. I have in mind especially the new research against spiritual disease like dementia or depressions in old age. More attention in general to the spiritual life, which does not concern exclusively the religious dimension in old age, but even on a large scale, intellectual and affective extra religious spiritual dimension. There is also a questionable side. The idea of living long only to rest and enjoy memories, for example, the idea of a passive life, the idea that one is not useful anymore, is something far from us. A completely passive life is not worth living. And a moral judgment, and this implies a moral judgment toward both the idea of itself of a passive and unuseful life, and a moral judgment toward persons who some way decide to embrace this kind of old life, this idea. In the second place, what the biblical and the classical models of old age fostered a desirable old age just because linked to the past, to an history as a golden age of virtue and potentiality, the Renaissance tradition, which developed from the first humanism and the rediscovery of humoral medicine, so a new intellectual life, but also the use of this new intellectual life as an instrument to improve the intellectual and physical life in turn itself. Something that helped to cure and maintain body and mind together. This is concentrated more on the present than exclusively, and no more exclusively on the past. Many Renaissance were suggested a model of senility whose values and virtues don't look only and don't come purely from the past. Elderly people can and should live in the present and for the present, thanks to a body healthy enough to allow their mind to express its power, basically. And there is the last, this is a shot, a picture from Being John Malkovich, in which I don't know if you saw it. Maybe Robert is too young to have seen it. I don't know, but already a 20 years old the movie, my God. But it represented a quite a totally bright idea of the eternal youth that renew itself at each generation, that there was this line quite emblematic. So, oh my God. So the young, the protagonist, Craig Schwartz, who said, the elderly have so much to offer. You are our link to history. And his chief, there was this old man who dreamt to live forever. I know what be your goddamn link. You have no idea what it means. So seems to me quite synthetic to close and sum up the whole paper. So thank you for the patience and thank you for your attention.